Self-Publishing Podcast, starting the new year off right, episode number 139.
This episode of the Self-Publishing Podcast is brought to you by 99 Designs, the online marketplace that helps you get outstanding book cover designs at an affordable price. Start your custom design today at 99designs.com/SPP and enjoy a free power pack upgrade valued at $99.
Welcome to the Self-Publishing Podcast, where if you want something done right, you've got to do it yourself. And now, here are your hosts, three guys who sometimes use their powers for good instead of evil, Johnny, Sean, and Dave.
Hey, everyone, and welcome to the Self-Publishing Podcast, the podcast that follows three full-time authors as we attempt to change the face of indie publishing. Join us in our trailblazing guests as we shove aside boundaries, freely experiment, and occasionally screw up. I'm Johnny B. Truant, and my co-hosts are Sean Platt and David Wright. And I'd just like to say for all of us, for the sake of just setting the pace, Dave, calm down. Calm down.
See, I was going to open with that. Yeah, Dave's just a bundle of energy. You know what's funny is Amy sent an email this morning. It might have been Slack. I'm not sure. But she said something like, you guys, you and Johnny need to drink Red Bull just to get on Dave's nerves, because it was already, I was like, wee, I love 2015, this is the best year ever, and she said, happy first SPP, I think you guys need to drink Red Bull, and Dave will just hate you all.
Dave more already hates us all.
Well, no, that's not really possible.
Oh, yeah. Well, how was everybody's Christmas? I know we'll probably get to this on BOU, but I just have to, just since we've taken 2 weeks off, it feels very strange. No meetings, no, of course, we've been chattering back and forth anyway, but.
I didn't think we were doing BOU today, are we?
Well, it'd be a shame if we didn't.
Yeah, I asked Johnny if we weren't. He said yes with an exclamation point.
Well, I guess we don't have to. I was actually just listening back to the episode. I don't know, before we broke, and you said something about your family was going to be home, so maybe you couldn't do BOU. And
oh, that's right, that's what it was.
But I thought we had decided that whatever. We'll go with what you.
We can do a lame version of it.
Oh, well, I think way to sell it.
Yeah. I think
this is like when you say you're trying to jog and you say, well, I'll just go out and run around the block, and then the theory is that you'll get into it, and so let's agree to do the lame version and then you know that it'll turn bad.
I'm sure Dave saw relatives or something to make his anger brew. But I thought it was no meetings, but yes on BOU.
Whatever. Well, I guess then the meeting that we sort of agreed to was, I don't know, I'm sort of done.
So much for resolution.
Well, but yeah, what's what?
No, go ahead.
Well, it was so not a break for me, but it doesn't matter because, like, this is what I would do, this is what I want to do anyway, so, like, I got up a little later a lot of days, I wrote less, and I didn't do, like, I don't know, I didn't do a lot of the little things that I sort of normally make myself do, but I have been working every day except for Christmas, and kind of maybe sometimes a little harder than I've been in terms of detail. Like, we have a lot of new stuff kind of going on, so it's been great. It's been an amazing 2 weeks, for me, anyway.
Yeah, it's for me, it's going to be hard to... It's going to be hard to get back into the rhythm because I have been working. I've worked every day. But I don't have any rhythm whatsoever. My children are home, and I've been waking up later.
Children ruin everything, don't they?
Well, in Dave's world, they're the enemy. Mine, they're a distraction. But I wake up later, and because my office is our bedroom, I don't want to just go and start working. So I leave my MacBook Air right now.
I'm just laughing at Dave's smirk over there.
I'm imagining sharing a bedroom with Sean and, like, how I would be sleeping in and Sean be up at 5 in the morning. Hi, honey! Throwing shit at him.
It's much funnier to imagine you having your office in your bedroom. And when would that work like?
That would be awesome. So, I take up my laptop, and my laptop has exactly 1 hour of battery life. that's exactly how long it will last. Right, and it's an Air.
What kind of laptop is it? Oh, MacBook Air with 1 hour of battery life.
You know, they make these things that plug into the wall too. It extends battery life greatly.
No, I'm actually happy with this because it
has 1 hour.
No, it has 10 hours, but it's old. Oh, like it needs a new. I need to go take it in to get a new battery. But whatever. Like I have.
You went to Apple to force you to go to them to get a new battery. They fucking suck.
Yeah, they're the worst. So
happy New Year, everybody.
So it's kind of cool because I wake up. This has been the routine all week. I wake up. I go. I got 1 hour, and I just work for 1 hour until Ethan gets up, and then we hang out for a little bit. And then Cindy goes to hot yoga, and I hang out. And it's just, like, I'm not getting to work for, like, a while. And so even though, like, I'm always occupied pretty much every moment since I wake, I'm just not getting that much stuff done. So I'm looking forward to next week when I can actually have rhythm and flow again because I do like my schedule. I do feel like I'm much more productive when I'm minding the clock.
I've been taking my laptop out into the other room and just doing a lot of stuff while I'm sitting in a chair with my feet up. It makes me feel like I'm on vacation, but I'm still doing stuff. Like I've just been doing a lot of admin sorts of things that are brainless and that it's okay to have a TV on and stuff. And so it's been a great break for me.
So are you excited to start back to the grind? No, or?
Yeah, I am because I need boundaries. And one of the things is, I think I talked about this on a BOU, I either give myself permission to do whatever I shouldn't do, or I don't. I'm very binary. And so right now I'm in giving permission mode, and everything falls apart. Like, I don't have a little bit of discipline. I either have super, super discipline, or I have no discipline. So
yeah,
it's
I'm a lot the same.
Cookies, yeah. And of course, I live in Ohio, so it's been very shitty out, and so it's just very claustrophobic. Like, we don't want to leave the house, and then that perpetuates, and I eat more shit, and so I'm diabetic, so my blood sugar gets fucked up, and then I say, okay, I need to do better, and then I do for a little while, and then I eat more cookies, and then I don't move, and it's
just... on vacation, you're like Dave.
No, I am too. I'm terrible. I've eaten, like, such shit.
Wait, no, hold on. I'd like to follow that progression. So on vacation, you're like Dave, and then Sean says, no, I am too. I'm terrible.
No, it's true. A couple days ago, we went to a Chinese buffet for dinner, and I used to love buffets, and I'm just not a buffet guy anymore because I'd rather have.
I hate buffets because you can't. You want some of everything, and then you make yourself ill.
Right? No, it's like I at this point in my life, I prefer quality over quantity. No. Yeah, quality over quantity. But I was not on the quality train at all. And I just kept thinking of Joey in the Vegas episode. Now here's where I win my money back. Right? So I'm going up. I did 9 trips up to the buffet. It was fantastic. And then, of course, I ate till I made myself sick. And I know the whole time I'm going for more. Oh, I'm going to be so sick. But it's delicious.
That's the worst when you know that you're doing the wrong thing. You know you shouldn't do it. You know this is the moment where I decide not to do it. And then you fucking do it anyway.
That's right, and it's like, it's the holidays. It's totally fine. So, yeah, I've been a pig.
Like me every day.
Every day is a vacation.
Exactly.
But I'll bet you've been working a lot just because you like the masochism of it. That's my guess. Have you been working harder than usual just so you don't enjoy it? Is that the way it works?
No,
or so you can avoid people?
No, I have. I've actually been spending time with my family and getting very little work done. I have been doing for the most part has been like scattershot. Like I'll sit down and start writing. Yeah, and then my son will come in and ask me or tell me something about Stampy Longhead. Thank you, Stampy Longhead, by the way, for making so many videos.
Who is Stampy Longhead? That sounds like a porn name.
No, it's like one of the biggest YouTubers that does Minecraft videos that are actually like safe for kids. It's entertaining. It's a British, I think he's British anyway, guy. Very entertaining.
He's just trying to get you to like him.
My son absolutely, well, yeah, I mean, he's British. I like him anyway. My son absolutely loves him, though, and just comes in my office, like, nonstop telling me what happened on a Stampy Longhead video. It's absolutely insane. So, yeah, I've been doing a lot of cover work. Sean's been like sending, hey, can you do a cover? And like, boom, I pound it out. And he's like, wow, that's kind of fast. Like, not doing anything?
Yeah. Well, okay, so quick cover note, actually, before we get into the topic, just because I thought of this, and I don't know if anybody cares, and we'll see. But one of the covers that we asked Dave to do recently was Write, Publish, Repeat. You think people are interested in this?
Oh, yeah, so, I definitely think
people... I don't know how this is going to work, but I love the cover for Write, Publish, Repeat that Dave did. It's white, it has orange text, it's a not too heavy of a serif font, and then it has a pencil horizontally through the center. And I love the cover.
It looks a lot like Daniel Kinnerman's Thinking Fast and Slow. Yeah. It looks a lot like that cover.
So we... I just love the cover, but I was looking through rankings and stuff. Like, I've been paying a lot of attention to lists and so forth this past 2 weeks, and I happened to look at the list, one of the lists that it's ranking on, and Steve Scott's 61 Ways to Sell More Nonfiction on Kindle is in that that cluster with us, and there's I think that How to Make a Killing on Kindle, which is a black one, and Nick Stevenson has a fantastic book called How to Supercharge Your Kindle Sales that's in there. And these all have bold covers. Like, they jump out at you. And ours was getting lost. Like, it was almost like you wouldn't be able to tell. There's no book in there. Why is there this white hole just because of the smaller size? And so we asked if Dave could add some punch to it. And so he added some colored bars and stuff. And the cover actually isn't live yet, despite the fact that I put it up several days ago. For some reason, recently, Amazon takes days to update a cover a lot of times. But my hope is that just the, you know, cover has to jump. A cover has to pop. And ours was not. And my hope is that people browsing those category lists will notice it who weren't before. So we'll just see if that makes a difference.
Yeah, I think this is a really good lesson, too, because if you know what book you're looking for, then it's not really an issue. But if you're hoping for that discoverability, which is a huge, huge, huge thing for authors, right? It's pretty much the biggest thing that we need to worry about is getting your readers to our work. And it's really easy to lie to yourself and think, oh, my cover looks great, or it's doing its job. And this is true with web design, too. You don't know what you don't know. And you don't know what the average, you know, reader or visitor to a site, what their eye is actually doing. And, you know, covers, it's hard because it's not like you can split test covers, right? I mean, you could do it on your own site, but you can't do it on Amazon. And you can't pay to have two covers and figure out which one, you know, is best and then, you know, continue to A-B that. Like, that's not really practical. But every once in a while to really, you know, take the time to look to see how your cover looks amongst the others on the pages, and if it is drawing the eye, that's important. And ours, you know, ours was admittedly getting lost. As a print book you hold in your hand, it's beautiful, but that's not the environment it was living in. And so, you know, that's a good way to goose sales. If you know, and it's hopefully. it's also one of those things where people can become blind to it. You know, if it's showing up in a lot of also bots and people, their eye is just blind to it at that point. But then all of a sudden, you know, it's black and orange and it looks different. And, you know, their eye is going to catch that that's different. And then maybe they've already decided without even knowing why, you know, the human brain is a funny thing. Without even knowing why, this customer has decided they don't want to read, write, publish, repeat for whatever reason, you know, whatever. And they decided that 6 months ago. So now every time it shows up in also bots, it's just kind of in their eyes way. But all of a sudden, it looks different. It's black and it's orange, and it draws their attention, and they click on it without even knowing why, and they read the description, and all of a sudden, it tickles a different nerve than it did 6 months ago when they decided it wasn't for them. And maybe we've earned a buyer that we wouldn't have otherwise, even though that buyer has already seen the book and formerly decided not to give it a try. So it's always worth it.
And for the record, I actually like the original cover quite a bit better than the revision. But it's I think that like Sean said, the brain is a funny thing. And if you're even though like you could say logically somebody knows there's a book there, logically. But there a lot of people will kind of tune off. They'll be like, oh, this one over here, like Nick's cover is really dynamic. Like you look at that and you're like, whoa, look at that cover. And if ours is next to it, like they click on that one and they forget about ours, and that can happen. So we'll see. But we rank very well in a few categories, and if people are browsing the categories and they are passing it over because of the cover, so I don't know.
It was too white before.
And Amazon's pages are white, and so it just kind of got washed out. And that font that I really like, I like it at full size, and I like it at our thumbnail size on the page. But in a list, it's even smaller. It's like 100 pixels or something, and it gets too thin, and you just can't see it. So there you go. All right. So do you want to today? We're going to talk about our goals for 2015, which for me have sort of evolved over these past few weeks. But do you want to do some of these voicemails first?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I like how I ask that, and then if you guys say no, you look like assholes.
No, we don't want to hear from people that have questions. Fuck, no, man.
I like voicemails. I like voicemails so much because they're the opposite of email, you know, where you get a question, and you're answering them one at a time. And, you know, voicemails are great. You know, you get a question, and they help a lot of people with one answer, and I love that.
Don't you love people that ask, like, 6 hours worth of questions?
It's one of the things I have to do better about this year. And Amy's been not only helping on a regular basis, but encouraging me to, look, dude, you got to stop doing that. Because I'll turn down very high-paying consulting work, and I have for 2 years now. I've not taken a single dollar for consulting at all. And the reason why is because when I was doing it, I wasn't building my business. I wasn't building our business, and I'm just not interested in that. And yet, I'll answer very long, detailed, you know, very excruciating emails, you know, one-on-one, just because I feel bad not doing it. And it's so dumb. And this is great. Helping people is something I'm very interested in. But the one-on-one in email, and it's hard, and it's not scalable.
In the early days of Collective Inkwell, I was doing a little bit of web design work, and I would get email from people all the time asking me, like, questions, just insanely complicated questions about web design. People that weren't paying me, people that, you know, they knew us, so, hey, I can ask you for free stuff. And it was really simple shit that, like, I spent tons of hours learning this stuff on my own, but they can't be bothered to. That's kind of a shitty attitude.
Yeah, one thing, too, that's hard is when they'll say something like, well, I know that you're going to cover this in an upcoming almanac, but I'd like an answer now. And that's hard because it's like,
I want you to spend 6 hours telling me now.
Right. And an email like that seriously can take a half hour to answer. Like, if I'm doing a thorough job and I'm answering all these questions, it could take a half an hour, and I can get three or
your
four.
Your time isn't worth anything.
So anyway, I'm definitely, we're trying to find new ways to answer questions like that. We're getting regular questions in a very regular basis where they can help multiple people at once. And that's why I like voicemails. So that's why I was a voicemail. Voicemails are wonderful. I love them.
What we should do is say from now on when you email us, we will read it on air as a voicemail. It, you know, as long as it's not personal. That way we can help more than one person at a time.
Well, the problem is how many we get.
Well, yeah, but I mean, we could pick the ones we think will help the most people.
Well, they could go into an Ask Us Anything.
The Japkin thing, yeah.
And we just answer them when we have. But then the problem, I feel like we're putting people off, you know. And it's just we have to find that sweet spot where we're trying to help as many people as we can. But
we err on the side of being nice. Amy keeps telling us, stop being nice. No, she doesn't say that. She says you have lots of ways to spend your time.
Yes, our head of customer service keeps telling us to stop
our
being nice.
Our studio manager.
It's true.
So, all right. So the beauty of these voicemails, I'm realizing, is that we've already answered three. So we only have one left, which is great. So we're doing great, guys. We're already...
Oh, we're fantastic.
Ball out of the park. So here is a question about podcasting, actually.
What's up, Sean? This is Buck Nasty in this piece, fool. Calling for the Self Publishing Podcast.
Did you listen to that?
Okay, so no, I'd just like to point out I hadn't listened to this one first, so I'm enjoying it for the first time along with you. Okay, so I think that deserves a replay, don't you?
I hope it doesn't go off into this tirade of offensive thing.
Well, I'm hoping that Jacob would have not put that in, you know, like would have said, oh, let's not include this one, so let's find out.
Right.
Okay, here we go again.
What's up, Sean? This is Buck Nasty in this piece, fool. Call for the self-publishing podcast and this bitch. Want to talk to Johnny, Sean, and that sexy Justin Bieber haircut having motherfucker Dave. I'm making the number one hole in my stable. I'm calling. I was wondering if you had any advice on podcasting specifically. What's a good way to promote a podcast, and do you think that most writers should have a podcast? Thanks, and have a nice day.
You have?
Yes, I love Dave's beard. It reminds me of my mama's pubic hair.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Welcome to all our new listeners for 2015. Wow. Let me just answer the first part of that and say that, no, I don't believe every writer should have a podcast, not even close.
Yeah, I think most writers should not have a podcast. I think podcasts are...
Only if you're going to make Justin Bieber jokes, then you must have a podcast.
Mm-hmm. I think podcasts are actually really, really oversaturated. But I also think that they're... having said that, we plan on launching two more podcasts this year.
So if you're not us, then fuck off.
So I think that I've started listening to podcasts for the first time just this last few months. And I think I have like 7 or 8 that are in my regular rotation now.
You're a piker.
And I really like the format a lot. My daughter started listening to podcasts over Christmas break. She listens
Better
to
Off Undead?
No. She listens to Sword Art Online, which is an anime discussion group that she's really into. Whatever. But the point is, like, I get why they're awesome, because they can be really niche, and that's great. But until you have a fan base or something specific to talk about, or just a really specific, tangible strategy that you're trying to implement, a podcast is most likely a diversion. So I think that both the podcasts, you know, that we have coming out this coming year, they're very specific with what we're trying to do. And I think that the answer why most writers shouldn't have one is actually an answer to your first question, which is, how do you promote one? They're really hard to promote. There's a lot of competition, and you're asking somebody to give you your time. And I think that it's really hard to grow that audience if you don't already have a small audience to start with. So it's much easier to go from 1 to 2 than 0 to 1. And so I think that it's probably a good idea to kind of to wait, you know. And I don't know. If you're just asking if you should have a podcast, the answer is probably no. Okay. If you have something specific to say, go ahead, Dave.
Well, I was going to say, it depends on what you want to do with a podcast. If you want to ramble and like do Better Off Undead, I would suggest not doing it unless you already have an audience. If you want to fill a hole that's not currently being served, much like Sean's mom.
Wow. Anyway, that was uncalled for.
I was speaking to our caller. He likes that kind of humor.
Yeah.
Anyway, no, I like if you if
there's
you
Dave talk, knowing his audience.
Yes, if you want to talk about like a show that's like really good out there that, you know, there aren't a lot of podcasts devoted to that you really love, and it's like sort of a cult show, and it has like the same, like, say X-Files, just, you know, an old show, but like say X-Files is out right now, and that was like the book you're writing. You could do a podcast about that and kind of attract the same sort of readers to it if you really have like a love for the topic. That sort of thing I would definitely consider doing. If you're just doing something just about you and people don't know you yet, that's a harder sell.
Yeah, I agree. And I would also add that, again, it's about your outcome. You know, I mean, I'm answering this question specifically on, you're saying, how do you promote a podcast? So I'm assuming it matters to you how many people are listening, and that's where you find justification for the time. When the three of us started this podcast, we literally did not really care how big it got. It was a matter of, look, we're doing this stuff, we're talking about this stuff, it's a live mastermind for us, and in a way, it's almost just us kind of capturing, you know, our bullshit. And it evolved into something else. You know, we changed along with our audience, and I think that's a good thing. But I think there was a long stretch there where we all agreed, look, we would do this just because. Like, we would just do this because it's helping us to grow. You know, it's helping us thrive as artists by having these out loud conversations and talking about what is and isn't working in our business. And if there's something there where it's creatively feeding you, or it's, you know, it's a good excuse for you to talk to people in your community, or it's a good excuse for you to to talk to people that you want to learn from. Like, there's a lot of reasons to do a podcast that aren't about you growing your audience. You know, maybe it's you thinking out loud and that's enough. But you have to know why you're doing something. Don't just do it because, oh, I've heard that writers, it's a good idea for writers to have a podcast, because I think that's erroneous.
Unless you have just a crap ton of time and you're a full-time author, for most people, an hour that you spend podcasting, which for is, you know, for a lot of people, especially starting up, it's going to be more than an hour's worth of work to produce a podcast, is an hour that you, a spare hour, like an hour that you don't have a lot of those hours, and you're spending it on podcasting instead of spending it on emailing your list or refining your calls to action or writing a better book description. Or, in other words, I guess what I'm saying is you don't have an endless amount of time to work on your books, probably. I mean, I know we don't, and we're full-time authors, and so for most people that time is better spent somewhere else.
So, we have a couple of comments.
All right.
Kate Morgan says, I have this picture of Dave hunched over his computer on Christmas refusing to use coal like Scrooge. And Quotidian Light says, Sean, I want to thank you again for helping me with my email. It was a huge help, and I appreciated it. My phone computer wasn't playing nice with the voicemail system, and you replied so much faster than I ever expected. You are a blessing.
Get ready for a torrent.
After you, bitch.
No, my pleasure. You know, and that's the thing.
You're horrible, that's the man.
That's what makes it difficult, is that I genuinely like helping people, and I like those exchanges, and I like knowing that something that I did helped to propel somebody else, or, you know, give them a little bit of juice with whatever their question was. The problem is, you know, there have been days, especially this last year, there were days where I spent the majority of my time in email. I would lose 4 or 5 hours in email,
there are people that don't help themselves. They'll, like, ask really simple shit that, you know, they could get if they fucking use that little thing called Google.
Yeah, that is absolutely true.
A few of those, yeah.
And if they can't respect your time, then you really shouldn't respect them. But
that is absolutely true. But that's not. I won't go out of my way for that kind of email. I'll go out of my way. I know exactly what, you know. Quotidian's email was perfect. Like, she had perfect respect for my time. She had a specific question that she knew I could help answer. And it wasn't like a deep, like, I get emails that are like bullet point lists, like, you know, in order, with very detailed, specific, the kind of thing, basically it's a consulting call. You're asking for me to take a consulting call and distill it into an email, which even takes longer than a consulting call, and to do it for free, and to do it one-on-one, and that's just much, much harder to do. And I need to write more this year. I need to produce more this year. And so I need to find ways to intelligently scale the same Q&As. But you're absolutely welcome. It was my pleasure.
All right. So my question, as we're recording this, it's January 2nd, and I think we all three have definitely made all sorts of New Year's resolutions.
Oh, yeah.
And it always involves, right, like, we're going to write
Dave's a ninja
more
about his resolutions.
Going to write more books is definitely one of them, and I just wanted to check with you guys on something, because I can write the books, but there's nowhere that I can get good covers. And so, can I just put a book up with no cover? Is that
Even with Dave's, you need to get them so they show up a year later.
What?
You know, with the right publish, repeat, disappear.
Yeah, stay out of the ad read. I mean, no, stay out of the spontaneous discussion.
If only there were a... Wait, there is a place. 99designs.com.
Oh, you forgot that your role there. Yeah. You thought you were the guy who was going to say, if only there were a place. Sorry, I'm that guy today. Go ahead.
No, this is the new year, and if you want to take your writing seriously, you want to get a professional cover. And if you don't already know a designer that you have lined up or whatever, and you don't know where to go, I suggest 99designs.com, because they have a stable full of designers that can help you get a professional quality looking book cover. We've used them several times. And every time we've been blown away every single time we've used them. We've never had a situation where we even had an easy choice to make. We've always had multiple choices to make. Basically, you go there, you say, hey, I have this cover I want to do. This is what it's supposed to be like. You give them a little bit of what your story's about. You might give them some sample images. These are other covers I like. I want something kind of along the style. And like within the first, I think you can get it done in about a week. And a bunch of designers will compete to give you like the cover that you want, and you get to choose among the best. And
if it's terrible, then you're only out $300. And
no,
who cares?
No, you're not, because with 99 Designs, you have absolutely nothing to lose.
Oh, thank God.
If you don't like it, you don't pay for it.
All right. Can you use it then? What if you don't like it? Can you just use it and then not pay for it? I don't think
you can't do that, because they do have assassins, I believe, that will hunt you down and murder you.
All right, so there you go, 99designs.com, your place for covers or assassins. So start your custom design today at 99designs.com/SPP, and you'll get a free power pack upgrade if you use that link, valued at $99. And the power pack upgrade makes your contest to stand out from the crowd, bold the listing, and give it a prominent background, and on average you're going to get around 185% more designs. And frankly, if you aren't using the power pack upgrade, you're some sort of a subhuman animal. So
you're a bastard, really. You are.
Yes, you are. So do you want to move into the topic at hand here, our goals? I know that
36 minutes in. Are you sure you don't want to wait another 20?
Well, that's the MO. You're acting like that's atypical. We had a lot to catch up from.
More focused for the new year. Get into the topic a little earlier, but yes.
But everything that we've already covered was pertinent stuff that is like, well, there was a little bit of bullshit.
Dammy Longhead.
All right. But people show up.
He has to complain, though. Wouldn't you be sad if Dave didn't complain? If one of his resolutions was less complaining in 2015, wouldn't you
My
call
wife
bullshit?
Would be happier.
I would be sad.
Yeah, there's none of that. There's none of that. Dave's misery is our pleasure.
So there you go. We did do a post on our goals, but my focus has changed a lot over these past few weeks. So I don't know. Who wants to begin the goals discussion? Sean, you wrote the post.
Well, I know Dave probably thinks this practice is really cheesy, but I kind of like the idea of, you pick like a word for the year, right? And I think that...
Oh, we can't say iterative anymore, can we?
No, like...
it was last year's word.
Last year's word was iterative, and it really was an iterative year. We really
when
did
we say the word of the day, can we all go, ah!
Oh, I forgot word of the day. That shit was tight. Oh, good stuff. Yeah, it really was. Last year's word was iterative, and I think that we followed it to a T, and we really followed, the principles of the lean startup, basically, where, you ship something, and then you just try to iterate it to be better and better and better. And last year was amazing. Last year was the year that, even though Sterling and Stone existed as a concept and a name before last year was the year where we're like all for one and one for all, and harmonized everything and put it all under one domain, and we need to get a lot better at that, but we moved toward it last year in the most wonderful way. And I know I'm all ready for Dave to roll his eyes at this year's word, and it'll probably change, but right now I think the word is harmony. I think that we have all of these elements and we really want them singing in the same key. I think that's really, really important to having the prosperous year that we want to have, because we have this going on and this going on and this going on, and we have all these ideas and we have all these things started, but it's really time for them to sing in chorus and harmonize.
I know I'm not the only one who wants to know what Dave would have picked for the word of the year.
Dave, what's Dave's word?
Meh.
Meh.
Meh. Put it on a t-shirt. I don't think I would have picked harmony. I appreciate harmony. But I don't know what single word this would be. But for me, we said that I know, especially with Realm and Sands, the 2000...
Optimization maybe is better?
Yeah, optimization might be a good way. Let me describe this in a little more verbose way, and we'll see. 2013, especially for Realm and Sands, was... production, like that was produce. last year was iterative growth and improvement, but not harmonized. It was just like, let's improve this a little, let's improve this a little, and because there was so much to improve, it wasn't harmonious. It was just like, let's, you know, see what we can do, and there's so much. But for me this year, it's like we now have just a shit ton of product. And so now this is the year we make it work for us. Like, this is the year where we say, okay, let's really focus on, it's still improvement for me, but I don't know how to encapsulate.
I think optimization is a good word. I think optimizing what we have, but it's those two things. It's optimizing, but it's also getting everything we have to work together. Because what we've done is really, really difficult, you know, and a lot of people wonder why we don't just write in the same genre and hammer it over and over and over so that we can, you know, maximize our revenue. And it's because our company hasn't been revenue driven. And this year we need to drive a little more revenue. We need to be a little more specific about that. And so two things have to happen. We need to optimize everything, but we also need to get everything working together, because having six different lines is not an easy task. It's on paper, that's a ridiculous, stupid thing to do. And so if we optimize them and we make sure that they're all working together, things like our autoresponder, you know, getting that going, that is a very sweet example of optimization and harmony, because it's a way of blending all of our different imprints into one cohesive message for our ideal reader and optimizing as we go. So I think those are different words, but I think that they work really well together.
Let me, before we go into the nitty-gritty here, let me just pull it back a little bit for the person who doesn't say, well, I don't have a shit ton of product. I don't have six lines. I haven't been
iterative. I don't have a word.
I don't have a word of the year. Optimization applies to, it's a scalable concept. So if this is your year for optimization, if you optimize as you go, then these things will still apply. So there you go. So do you want to begin with goals on the list, or how do you want to do that?
Yeah, I guess I can just go through these one by one.
Hey, paste the link in the chat if you would. I don't have it.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Hold on.
Do you make New Year's resolutions, Dave? I don't either. Yeah. So
I actually totally do. New Year's has always been one of my favorite holidays. I know it's silly, and I know most people think resolutions are stupid.
You make goals. I have a hang-up with the word resolution, because it's usually some bullshit thing that, oh, I should do this, and that's why I'm deciding, because I've been told I should, and nobody does it. It's different.
Yeah, no, I don't do it by that definition at all, but I do look at my year. I'm very reflective this time of year. I really think hard about how I spent my year and how I want to spend my new year. And I mean, I'd say ever since I was a kid, like ever since really 18, I started seriously doing this every year. And I would say that every year it's made a difference. You know, I can look back on the last 20 years of my life and see a lot of tangible growth, because I think I take the time to care each year. So I understand the objection to the word resolutions, but I mean, I tie it in, you know, I feel like it's outcomes for me, you know, like what are my New Year's outcomes? What do I want to see in 2015? And I start thinking heavily about the new year, you know, at the end of the old year. So anyone, I mean, you guys know, and I started stressing Jacob out, you know, like at the end of October, really. And I'm like, look, we're wrapping this year up. We need to start preparing for next year. These are all the things we need to do. And there was that long almanac post that was like 93,000 words that made Dave throw up in his mouth, that were like, look, this is all the stuff we have to finish before this year, because next year's going to start and we're not prepared. But I think that it's important to know where you're going, because then you can, you know, you can build your mile markers into it. Right. And I think that that's just really important, whether you're doing, and it's important to keep sight of that too. As Johnny just said, even if you're just a one man band, and you've got one book to your name, and you know, you don't need a word, you're not trying to optimize and harmonize and iterate, you still want to know where you're going, because you're going to get there faster, and you're going to get there, you know, with less headache. It's not about avoiding mistakes, because as you know, anyone who knows me knows that I firmly believe that mistakes are a prerequisite to success. I think that you have to make mistakes along the way. So it's not about avoiding mistakes. It's just about optimizing your life and making sure that you're tilting the mistakes that you make towards your eventual success. So anyway, the first thing on this list is a return to form for Collective Inkwell. And I'll let Dave talk on that for a moment before I blah, blah.
Well, essentially, in 2012, we wrote a shit ton of stuff. We wrote more than humanly possible, it feels like. And in 2013, I think, you know, we were still writing, but some of it was for 47 North, and it kind of messed with our schedule a little bit. In 2014, felt like, I don't know, I always felt busy, but I think we wrote the least in 2014. So we definitely need to pick it up. We need to close some stories out. We need to, you know, we have some new stories that we'd like to write. And we want to definitely write more this year.
Yeah, I think there's two sides to that. I think for the Inkwell, we want to. I think there's something that I really want to recapture, and it's two pronged. I want to recapture reader enthusiasm. You know, there was a magical time in 2012 when it was because we were producing every week and we had readers just waiting for what was next, and that was exciting. Like, that was exciting to be on that side of creation and have people waiting for what was next. Like, that was really, really cool. So we've got a couple of ideas to figure that out. Like, I love these ideas, and we're they're right around the corner. And I think that Dave is fueled by that kind of thing too. You know, when it's not just, you know, yes, he cares about what I think and he wants to, you know, please me and meet expectations and do all of that. But it's also, you know, when there are readers and there are fans and they're chomping at the bit for what's next, that fuels him too, and that drives him on a more creative level. And so, so I think that one can beget the next. You know, I think that if we have fans who are, you know, eagerly waiting for what's next, we're going to go a little bit faster, and by going a little bit faster, we're going to find momentum, and by finding momentum, we're going to harmonize. And I think that's a good thing. I think that when there's creative chemistry between Dave and I, it is magical, and it allows us to do great work in less time. And I believe that we'll find that again this year. And it's just a matter of doing it and getting going.
We had a good start with the Mauricio story.
Yeah, we just finished a Mauricio story, which was actually really hard for me to write. You know, normally Mauricio started as pretty much the easiest thing that we wrote, just because he was anything goes. But we've written him for 5 seasons and 4 standalone stories, and so there's like a lot of baggage with the character now, and there's expectations, and we don't want to make him a parody, and there's mythology to adhere to. So, and it was winter break, like. I didn't want to write, so it was very hard to get out. But
pussy, I wrote a bunch of Robot Proletariat over break.
So yeah, so it was Dave and I. It was Dave and I at our best, and it was really, really fun. And the other project that we're working on for CI, that's a big title coming up soon, was great. And so I'm feeling it with CI, and I think that it's going to be a great year for the Inkwell.
And I can't wait to see what happens when CI is at peak form while Realm and Sands and the other imprints are at their peak form. Like, I think there'll be a lot of harmony.
Yeah. Right. No, I think that it's awesome because we've started everything. Everything started. But now we're going to see everything pop, and we're going to see how those intersections are there. And that's very exciting. The second thing on this list is Launch Fiction Unbox 2. I don't think we want to get into too much detail on that right now.
Especially since I'm not even sure what it is. So, well, there you go.
That's a good reason. So
I just know that it needs to be jaw-dropping, though, because there was an idea that in its original form that Sean pitched, and I said, well, that's interesting, and I think that's cool, but Fiction Unboxed made people think that we were going to start drooling all over them. It was so crazy, and this one wasn't quite that crazy, and so I think that this, I know that Sean teases that he has something that's gonna punch people again.
Forcing me to write a book in a month. And
yeah,
all
no,
of the fighting that'll be happening.
No, because I think that that would somehow make a tear in the space-time continuum, and I'm worried about that. so no. But the way this evolved,
I think the story meetings to be awesome.
I had a what I thought was a good idea for, because the reason we had 1.5 instead of Fiction Unbox 2 is because, like Johnny said, Unbox 2 needs to be substantial. It needs to be, you know,
iterative. Like,
it needs to be more than iterative. It can't just be, you know, a slight version. Like, it needs to
it needs be harmonious.
It needs to be a totally new idea, because Fiction Unboxed proved a point. You know, we had a point to prove, and we wanted to prove that point. Fiction Unbox 1.5 did not prove a point. It was just it was an iterative version of what we had already done. And Fiction Unbox 2 had to be
Fiction
something
Unboxed new. 1 proved a point, and Fiction Unbox 2 beat the dead horse. How much harder can we beat this point?
Right, and we don't want to do that. We needed it to be something new and original. So I came up with an idea, and I pitched it to Johnny, and he's like, that's cool, we could do that. But then I pitched him something else, and he like crapped his pants over it, and he really, really, really wants to do it, but I don't think we're ready to do it.
Terror, to be fair, like, it isn't all excitement. It's like, what's the matter with you a little bit?
Right, it's crazy. The idea I have is crazy. So it's officially kind of like Fiction Unbox 3, because there's just no way to do it right now. It's just, it's so crazy. But it was really funny to see his face, because after I pitched that, my original idea for Fiction Unbox 2 was like, brum, brum. He just didn't care anymore. It totally deflated. And so I had to go back to the lab with that, and I think that I found a way to make that idea really balls out awesome. So anyway, that'll come later this summer, and it is a full evolution. It's a totally different point we're proving. There we go. Awesome. And I think people will really shit their pants for it. It'll be awesome. Schedule the colonist session and plan for this fall's summit. We are really, really lucky to have Amy on board. Amy is our...
Oh my God, these two ladies that have joined the company are revolutionizing everything.
Yeah, we've got Amy Schubert, who is our studio manager, and Monica Leonel, who is our writer. And just really, really, really great stuff happening there. And already we've got a hotel. We want to talk about this now or kind of save it for later, some of the details?
Why don't you run through a little, just briefly just give a tease, because we do have more goals to get through and we've been on the air.
Yeah, so we'll close the show with a few more details.
Well, no, just go ahead and go into it, because we'll talk about it more in detail. We don't need to go into detail at all today.
Amy's really got the ball rolling here. We've got a hotel picked out. We've got dates, which are it's April 18th. Is that right? I don't have anything in front of me. Is it April
18th and 19th? April 18th and 19th of 2015.
And it's really awesome. And what's cool about it too is that, you know, when we did the summit, like, it really is about relationships. And when we did the summit, Monica was there, and Amy was there. And now they're both part of Sterling and Stone.
Like, Garrett was there, who is already basically part of it.
Right, and it's really cool. It's there's just so much value in in-person stuff, which is why we kind of want to spearhead some of that. Like, we know not Dave doesn't go to stuff, and he had to be dragged over to Austin, even though he had a great time. But Johnny and I very much see the value in in-person stuff. We try to get together in person as often as we can justify it. You know, we'll go to Denver in May. He'll probably be down here for South by Southwest. It's just, you know, you want to do those things. Relationships get better in person. There's just no substitute for eye-to-eye contact. And so, you know, that's really cool. And all the people who were there at the summit are coming to the colonist session. So that's very exciting. It's a continuation of something amazing. So I guess
it's gratifying too. You guys don't care about this, but it's gratifying to me because it means we did our job. Like, if they're willing to come back and pay again, that's pretty cool.
Oh yeah, totally. And I'm really excited about this. I'm very curious to see how because it'll be a different event. Like, the things we're talking about doing will be different, and we'll do a show dedicated to it, or I know blog post dedicated to it, and that's all coming up. But just the idea that we are going to launch the colonist session, because we promised that last year, and the summit was just too awesome not to do it again. So we'll be doing that, you know, probably in late summer or fall. So anyhow, that'll be really, really awesome. And I guess we'll move on down the list. For launch two daily podcasts. So this goes into what the our voicemail was asking about podcasts. So I really, really strongly feel that if you have a podcast, you really need to have a specific reason for doing that podcast. And for us, we have very specific reasons for both podcasts. The first one is we want to promote our fiction. You know, we love doing the self-publishing podcast, and we love Better Off Undead, but neither one are really doing much to promote our fiction. SPP does in a very quiet, you know, in the background way, but it really is for writers, and writers are, for the most part, concerned with their own books. You know, if they read our books, it's because they are curious. They want to see if, you know, if we know what we're talking about, can we really tell a story? Like, so there may be a curiosity element there. And there's also, oh, I like these guys. I'm willing to try their fiction. But those are both much harder sells. What we really want is for people to be digging our fiction and they want to go get more. And so we want to launch a podcast that is basically fiction. It's fiction every day. And, you know, we've seen a lot of success. You know, Serial was the biggest podcast of last year. And when that launched, I had a whole bunch of people, you know, phone me, email me, text me, like, what the hell? Why don't you have something like that? And, you know, what Serial did is much, it was very professional, and it was nonfiction based, and it's, you know, from the NPR people, so it's very polished. And we want to do something. We want to do something amazing because there's a lot of people who we're not tapping into who would love our fiction, and they've got a lot of time to kill on their commute. And so I think that being able to tap into that is a really good idea. And we had something going earlier in the year, but it just wasn't good enough. It wasn't good enough. We were releasing stuff that had already come out, and they were my readings, which just my reading is not good enough to launch a podcast like that with the kind of payoff that we wanted to have. And it was also, we were releasing stuff that we already have. So this goes back to our first goal too, where we want CI to, you know, a return to form for CI. And when we launch our podcast, our fiction podcast, it's going to be with exclusive material that is the only way you can get it for a window of time is in the podcast. So if we have, you know, goners who love our stuff, and they will sign up for the podcast, then that could really help fuel the podcast growth. But on the other hand, we're going to have people who are, again, waiting every, it won't be every week, it'll be every day, because chapters will come out every day, who are waiting for what's next, you know, we'll bring that water cooler back. And that's very, very exciting to me, both on a business, professional, podcast level, and on a creative, Collective Inkwell story level. So I'm really excited about that. And then we're going to have a Smarter Artist podcast, which is a little more to the point. You know, SPP is what it is, and we bullshit for 30 minutes before we get to the awkward ad read and then to the topic. But Smarter Artists will be very to the point. A lot of the, you know, we keep talking, it's funny how circular all this is. We keep talking about finding ways to scale that one-on-one questions. So a lot of those questions will just go into the Smarter Artist podcast. You know, so if somebody's asking, you know, how long should my Serial book be? That's a great question. You can spend a few minutes answering it the next time that question comes in. That goes into the podcast, and you can send somebody a link to that video or that episode. And
to be like a five to ten minute sort of a podcast, not an hour every day.
Right, but it will be every day, and so we think that, you know, that's scale too. iTunes loves daily podcasts because there's seven times the amount of downloads, assuming you have the same amount of the same audience size, and so both of those podcasts could hopefully grow very fast. One promotes the Smarter Artist and SPP, and the other promotes all of our other fiction lines, mostly CI and Roman Sands. So that's very exciting.
I would like to move that we sort of skip through, just mention 5 and 6 because they're a ways out. 5 is draft our first screenplay. Sean wrote that. I have no idea how to write a screenplay, but hey, I'm on board. But that is that's that's going to take some doing, and I don't know that we'd be ready to talk about that yet, but that's, we want to move into more media down the road. And number six was to build an app, which again is more of like, I mean, for us, a year is a very, very long time. I swear it's like dog years. Like we spent, you know, like a year in Sterling and Stone time or just in self-publishing in general feels like a very long time. And so by the end of the year, if we're, you know, middle of the year, if we're thinking about an app, that feels a really long way away to me. So I just wanted to, no reason to spend a ton of time on those. The next one is better meetings. I don't have a ton to say on this one either, but we do, that's part of the optimization. That's part of getting better at what we already do a little bit, and having Tara Jacobson outlining social media stuff for us and getting the ball rolling. We're going to need somebody to continue that, but she's handling a lot of that for us because we've been really not handling it at all.
She's done already just such an extraordinary job just getting
stuff we've just been letting drop.
Yeah.
And you know, with Monica helping us with our writing, I mean, she is writing. She's going to do some fiction, but it's really more like a marketing writer, like a copywriting. And so with Monica helping us with that, and Amy helping us with customer support and things like planning the summits, just being our
studio manager. I don't know how
to describe it. Yeah, studio manager. Is really going to free us to just get better at what we do. But that's part of the expanding team here. You've already kind of talked about Harmony.
It's actually on the list. More harmony between imprints.
So why don't we move to nine? Because this is, for me, this is the dominant one. And when I mentioned that my goals have shifted, it's not that they've shifted. It's that it's this. Like, this is the one that I've been sort of hyper focusing on. The total eclipse of the heart, right, Dave? No, total eclipse.
John's words.
A total eclipse of fiction to nonfiction.
Are you interrupting Dave singing? Listen to him back there.
And I think this is really, really, really important.
I love this song.
You know, right now, for us, the easy button is absolutely anything nonfiction, and yet it's what we're least driven to do. We're all storytellers. We want to tell stories. We want to tell as many stories as possible. We want to build worlds. Like, that's so exciting. And you know, we love the smarter artists. We love that vertical. We love this podcast. We love the emails. We love all of it. But we want to be storytellers. You know, when we talk about writing a screenplay someday, it's because eventually we want to see our worlds, you know, up on the screen, and there's movement towards that. And so it's a matter of optimizing what we have so that it all works together, and it is harmonized, and all of our fiction is then ticking, 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 because what we've done is we've just vomited all of these stories out into the world, and now they're there, and we haven't done a lot to optimize them, and now it's a matter of getting everything to just kind of click into place, so one cog turns another cog, which turns the big wheel.
And to that end, you'll hear a lot about this year. A large part of our audience is fiction focused, and so this is good for you guys because you're going to hear more of our experiments. Again, just to ram this point home, like we haven't been revenue driven, and so as a result, like a lot of, as Sean mentioned earlier, there've been we could have done things to enhance revenue streams that we deliberately turned away from in the interest of building that wide city block rather than building the skyscraper right away. And I think this is the year where you start to see the payoff. Like you start to see us turn in the direction of how do we optimize what we have for sale. Like this is where we start really saying, okay, now we are turning toward revenue driving. Like how do we make various series make money? And we are going to experiment. We have a lot to experiment with. Now, if you have a smaller catalog, you're going to have to make choices that, in an or fashion, that we will make in an and fashion. So a good example is, and I won't go into this in a ton, but we actually said in that Easy Button post that we don't like the idea of exclusivity wholesale at all, but that we do want to experiment a little bit to see if we can use select a little bit. And so there are a few things we're going to try. In no way are we moving back and saying, okay, well now you know, all our franchises are going to go select or anything like that. But we have the inventory to try it. And Lexi's line more than anything. And so, I don't know, I'm just very excited about the possibilities of that, the possibilities that come with the non-exclusive lines, too. We have some promotions coming up that I'm very excited about. I could run in circles on this all day. There's just a lot of stuff I've been doing.
Otherwise. Well, it's because it's the big one. It's the one we probably care most about on the list. It's one that will facilitate a lot of the other ones. You know, it's where most of our attention will be, and it's satisfying because what we're going to see this year is a big payoff for the few years that we've been digging. You know, we really made sure that we had a strong foundation before we started to go vertical. We really wanted to be fat horizontal. And, you know, I think that we've done a really good job preparing. And so 2015 is we're finally going to get to see a lot of our trees bear fruit. And that's very exciting. And, you know, we still got a lot of hard work ahead of us, but we like hard work. We're hardworking men. Like we enjoy the process. We enjoy the fruits, and watching fiction eclipse nonfiction is going to be a lot of fun, especially because we do have the inventory and we spent a few years really getting it all out there. And now everything is adding, and you'll see a lot more addition than subtraction this year, which is exciting.
And this is something that harkens back to some stuff we've talked about before, and I think it's a good lesson for any writer is we said one of the reasons that you need to produce more stuff, the reason that you need to write, publish, and repeat is partially so that your footprint is larger and more people can discover you and you have more interconnections. But part of it is that the further you are from something, the less dear you are to it. So part of the reason we're going to be able to do some of the experiments that we are is because we've produced enough to put some distance between us and that thing. Now, I don't want to go into a ton of specifics, but here's a good example that isn't what I'm talking about, but it's the type of thing I'm talking about, is when Ed Robertson suggested that I make the first four books of my Fat Vampire series, that bundle, 99 cents as for a promotion, I really, like, what? Like, that's... it was like my entire catalog at the time. Like, I have these four books. I don't want to make them 99 cents, even for a while, because it devalues the work, and I'm going to lose sales during that period of time, and people are going to think I'm cheap. And plus, that was my only income generator at the time. But now, with distance between so much of our stuff and the fact that we just have so much and we're using other people's stuff, like Lexi's line and stuff, you will be freer to experiment the more work you put out there, because you just say, well, so maybe I will make that first book permanently free, or maybe I will make it 99 cents for a big promotion or something where you wouldn't have before. So it's you want that freedom to experiment.
Yeah, something like Select hurts a lot less when you have the inventory. You know, if you've got...
That's a great example.
You know, if so what? It's 90 days of exclusivity on one title. Like, it doesn't matter. Let's see what happens. And then you can make informed decisions, because you don't want to base your business around, you know, unsubstantiated hypotheses or emotion. And for us, you know, the Select thing, it's a little of both. You know, we really hate the idea of exclusivity just on on principle. Right? Like, that sucks. Because the more that we feed that, you know, exclusivity beast, the worse it really is for the community long term. Like, it just is. Right? We're just giving them Poland. Like, that's all we're doing.
What's wrong with publishing, people?
Right. We want to not do that. Right? So, you know, if we're looking for what's best, and we really always try hard to think what would be best 5 to 10 years from now, and signing up for Select, you know, re-upping every 90 days is not what's best 5 to 10 years.
With everything that we do, yeah.
Right. Not just for us, but for all of us, for the indie community. It's not good to only grow within Amazon's ecosystem. But it gets a lot harder to, you know, play and to not dig our heels in when we've got inventory to play with. And what we've really started to do this last month is to take our core pieces apart and say, okay, what can we do with this piece? Now, what can we do with this piece? Now, how can we optimize this? Do we've got product descriptions we could rewrite. We've got covers we can update. You know, we've got CTAs in the back that we can update. How do we optimize this,
How do we turn a tactic, something like, let's put this title in select when we know that that's a tactic that may conflict with strategy if we aren't careful. How do we use that as part of a strategy? So,
right.
As an example, if we have something in select that does well because of the select machine, like if that's a select suitable title and it does well, then we can use that to drive traffic to stuff that isn't in select or to our mailing list or something like that.
Yeah, it's possible to make tactics strategies bitch, but it doesn't happen by accident. And you can't just assume that a tactic is going to serve your strategy just because you're using it. And that's what we've really taken time to focus on in this last month. And what we're starting the year doing is to really ask ourselves the questions. You know, why are we doing that, and what will it serve, and what do we have to do to make that happen, and what is our desired outcome? And these are just really important questions that you want to ask yourself, even if you only have 3 books or 2 books or 1 book. Like, ask yourself these questions. The why is just, it's too easy to skip over, and it's dangerous to do that.
This episode hasn't had enough Dave. Any new comments, Dave? Anything there?
Yes, we do have comments.
All right, let's hear them.
La, 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 la. Okay, Josh Hilden says, my first SVP is a full-time writer. No more day job. I can finally watch live. Congratulations,
I was just going to say congratulations to Josh. He tweeted that he is now full-time.
Congratulations, Josh. That's really, really awesome.
Missy Morgan says, so these ladies have saved your asses, guys. Yay, the females rock. Amy Schubert says, don't tell them I said this, but I'm kind of the team mom. Ha ha.
Oh, yeah, that's funny because I almost made that reference, and then I thought she might be insulted by it. And I said, no, like, that's good. Like, thank you, Amy, for going ahead and giving me permission.
Missy said, I can totally see that they need discipline and routine.
By the way, I would never argue with that. Like, the women in my life have always made me better.
Oh, I'm only functional because of Cindy. For sure. Like, she puts up with all my shenanigans, but also gives me the fences I need. It's perfect. Like, I love women.
Missy says, unrelated, but love the painting behind you, David. It's awesome. Yes, that painting is from my good friend who sent me the candied apples last year. This year she sent me something I wanted.
Finally got her shit together.
Are you worried the exposure of a painting that you have indicated is from a friend, plus the factoid about the candy apples, will allow somebody to triangulate on you through that friend and discover who you are and where you live?
No, not at all.
And I'd like to point out that Dave's office configuration has changed again, too.
Oh, of course it did. It's been 2 weeks. Well, what the hell?
I want, like, a rotating set.
You should just make your office in one of those revolving restaurants, and then you wouldn't have to change it. You could just move to the center every once in a while and back out.
I would love that.
Is that it? Is there more?
Fucking comments on YouTube suck. They disappear. Yeah, that's it for now. I can't find the other ones.
All right. So I think we
we're on the last. Yeah, we're on the last thing on the list, which is, I'll let Johnny do this one because it's his and it's exciting.
Get Johnny to Austin. I like that. That's a formal company goal.
It's
as
a
well,
former
too.
Company it, goal.
And totally. it does extend. It is get Johnny and Dave to Austin, but it's sort of like low-hanging fruit. Like, I couldn't get there soon enough if you know, once that it's possible. And Dave is a little tougher sell, I guess. But
well, Dave's a tougher sell on everything.
True.
But if you're here, it's only a matter of time before he's here. And so, you know.
Because I follow Johnny everywhere.
I was going to make that joke.
It's just it'll be really, really awesome. So no, it's about moving the team. It's about building the team. And but I think that's the number one next move is to get Johnny to Austin. So yeah, it's an official company goal for sure.
And I think that I do think that happens this year. I don't know necessarily that I relocate this year, but I think that the decision is made, the steps are taken. I'm just thinking it takes a long time to, like, sell a house. Like, we own a house with land, and that's... But I think that the decision is made this year. I think we're on our way.
So that'll be really exciting. Dave, Johnny's right. This was a Dave Light episode. So we need to hear some of your resolutions before we say goodbye, just because. what do you want for this year? Professionally, what do you want for this year?
I don't fucking know, man.
Dave wants an eclipse of nonfiction by fiction, right?
We should really do this show like 2 a.m. I could be in a much better frame of mind to discuss the things that I want to do, but yeah.
How about that's your resolution, your outcome, your most desired outcome? You want a daytime schedule that you actually keep.
Yeah, I was on daytime very briefly, but then Christmas break happened, so yeah.
So the time when your family is up and on the same schedule as you is when you fell off the wagon?
Yes.
Is that an avoidance thing? Ah, oh, fuck, they're up. I'm going to bed.
No, it's I'm spending time with the family, so I have to stay up to kind of balance that. But then when I the problem is, then when I stay up to do work, the work I do that late, I'm fucking exhausted and it absolutely sucks. So it's really not even worth it.
I have a proposal. Dave, I think this year you should move to Siberia. It's cold, it's dark, and the time difference would allow you to be on the air with us at 2 a.m. or whatever. Well, it's normal time for us. It'd be perfect.
That is a pretty good idea. You know what? This should be the year of the Nutribullet for Dave.
Yes.
The year I open it?
Yes, the year you open it. How long have you owned the Nutribullet?
Let's do an unboxing on Better Off Undead.
I like that. All right, so are we done with this dog and pony show?
Yeah, we could do the unboxing. I'm Better Off Undead.
All right, so are we done? Yes.
Yeah, it looks that way.
Yeah, next week we're going to have Steve Scott. Speaking of habits, yes, he's the habit guy. I read Steve's book, 61 Ways to Sell More Nonfiction Books on Kindle, over these past 2 weeks, and it was great. Steve will tell you it's a little dated. He needs to update it, but only the tactical stuff. It's great in general. And Nick Stevenson will be the week after that. And his book is How to Supercharge Your Kindle Sales, I believe. And that was great.
I read that over the holiday.
Oh, and shout out also, we aren't going to have Simon Whistler on again anytime soon, just because he's been on before, not terribly long ago. But Simon's book, Audiobooks for Indies, I read too, and it was great. So shout out to Simon. If you're interested in audiobooks, pick up his book. So there you go.
If the person that did his cover also did Nick Stevenson's, it kind of looks similar.
They are a little similar.
Yeah, it's really clear. It's really obvious.
That was like some strategy of copying it. we'll have to assault Nick on the show.
I know that Simon's is a 99 Designs cover because they...
Really?
99 Designs is sponsoring RSP and Joanna's show in addition to ours. So they're really cornering the market. But you should use our link, /SPP.
Yeah, our link is the perfect link.
It comes with a power pack upgrade and a Hummer from Dave.
What?
Okay, you know, the
that's what you should have ended the show, Johnny.
All right. So that'll be the end. And thanks for tuning in to the Self-Publishing Podcast. I really need to redo our end of show CTAs because this is a little out of date. But for now, if you'd like to get our best advice without all the off-topic bullshit, be sure to pick up Write, Publish, Repeat, the No Luck Required Guide to Self-Publishing Success at selfpublishingpodcast.com/WPR. And thanks for listening, folks, and we will see you next week with Steve Scott.
Stay tuned for Better Off Undead.
Or don't.